Well, good morning, Eagles Nest. It's so glad to see you online with us here today. Listen, I don't even have to say this. You could turn on the news, scroll through your social media, read a tweet or two, or drive around town, and you'd see the absolute worst in mankind. But you know, that doesn't have to define us. We're called to be salt and light. And here's how we can do it. 1 Peter 5:10 says, "And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast." So get excited today as Pastor Bob leads us in the next sermon in the series, Dare to Dream Again. In just a moment, our worship team is actually going to be playing live. You're going to get to see what it was like last week for the big grand opening. But before we do that, can I invite you for just a moment, right now, wherever you may be, to block out those anxieties, the feelings of doubt or hopelessness, lay them at the feet of the one who can restore peace. And let's worship him together. Enjoy the service.
Good morning, please stand with us. Put your hands together.
Story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous.
the most activity you've done on a Sunday morning in quite a while. Me included. God, we just have longed to be in your presence together, in your presence anywhere at any time. But God, to be here together is just something special. And I think you created it that way.
Yeah. Good morning, Eagles Nest. It is glad to have you with us this morning in the building for worship, and it's also wonderful having you in your homes worshiping with us in your living rooms. Today, we continue in our series called Dare to Dream Again. It's very important that we, as individuals, as a church, and as a nation, begin to dream again. I can't overstate this. It's very important that we look to the future and not just what's happening right now. It's very important for us to live in hope and not fear. At the end of every year, I seek the Lord for the focus of the coming year. I've done that since I started in ministry many years ago. This year in 2020, as some of you and many of you might remember, is I adopted a slogan, I choose hope over despair. At the time, I thought this was a little odd because everything was going so well. Truthfully, things around here were rolling and we were planning. We had big plans for the future and things were moving and progressing. And however, 6 months later, we find ourselves struggling to even choose hope over despair. God really does know what we need. I needed personally that slogan. I needed that focus to choose hope over despair. People have quoted that back to me hundreds of times over the last few months. And one of the ways that we can choose hope over despair, is to dare to dream again. And that's what we began to talk about last week and we'll continue this week. In fact, this week I spent some time studying and thinking about things, where things are likely to go for us in the next couple of years, and not to run from the issues, but to engage them. You know, I think that there's going to be a lot of uncertainty and disruption for the next couple of years. I mean, that's at least what the experts, whoever they are telling us. And so I spent some time this week studying where things could go. I also spent some time in a couple of meetings with people that I believe are in the know and know things, and just to discuss where they think things are going and how we should respond. So if we're going to dream again, we're going to have to begin to engage life, and we're going to have to address some fundamental questions in our lives. One of those questions that's been raised by the coronavirus is this the end of the world? I mean, people have asked me several times about it. I've heard preachers talking about it, and let's be honest. You could make a strong case for this being the end of the world, or certainly feels like it. I mean, a worldwide pandemic, what the Bible would call a plague, government overreach, and there's been plenty of government overreach, folks, empty shelves in the stores. I mean, I can't remember a time in my life, in my few 35 years plus, when I've gone to a store and not been able to find the things that I want because they're just not on the shelf. It's really been strange. I've seen it in other countries when I've gone to other countries, but I've never seen it in the United States before. Shortages like toilet paper. I mean, it's got to be the end of the world. If there's no toilet paper, at least it's the end of the roll. It may not be the end of the world. Now we have riots in our cities. Now they're talking of tracing us, and that all sounds like it has, you know, good things for us to take and make sure we're safe. But does anyone know what the House bill number? The House bill number talking about tracing the coronavirus is H.R. 6666. You can't make this up. I don't know what genius came up with that House bill number. They're either messing with our heads or somebody's doing something intentional. I don't know what it is right now. But when you see that kind of stuff, it's easy to begin to believe that we might be in the end of the world. I mean, this brings out all the prophecy teachers and all the prophecy books. One could suggest that maybe this is the big one. Remember Red Fox and Sanford and Son? He would say, this is the big one, Elizabeth. There's at times it just feels like right now that it's the big one, that this could be the end of the world. But I want us to think about this for a minute. When we ask the question, is this the end of the world? I don't think that's the right question, and here's why. It's hard to dream when our focus is on the end of the world. Now, the end of the world is kind of a downer. I mean, when you start talking about the end of the world, you're not going to write dreams down. In fact, I put it in the words of one of my favorite TV shows, Monk. Some of you may remember the show TV show Monk. Monk had one of the episodes where he went around saying, you're bringing the monk down. That's what happens when we focus on the end of the world. We get down. It brings us down. Even if you're having a great day and it's sunny outside and everything's wonderful, you begin to see rain clouds on the horizon and you get down. That's what happened to the church in Thessalonica in the Bible. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we're going to turn there and read a couple of verses. In 2 Thessalonians, in fact, the books of Thessalonians, I'm having a hard time talking today. in Thessalonians, we find that the church in Thessalonica was focused on the end of the world. Let's read it in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. Paul writes, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come." This church was extremely focused on the coming of Jesus Christ and the end of the world. That was their big thing. That was their big focus. So do you know what they did? They stopped living. They just stopped. They sheltered in place. They just began to just not live life. They stopped working. If you read both of these books in the Bible, they stopped working. They stopped dreaming. They just stopped. And because they stopped living, they began to start other things. They began to be busybodies. They became disorderly and troublemakers, and they became lazy. Now, I didn't draw the parallels. If you're drawing the parallels, there's some parallels here to what's going on in our society right now. And so the Apostle Paul writes to correct them and to tell them, hey, guys, start living again. And in order for us to live again, folks, we have to start dreaming again, because life flows out of our dreams. Without dreams, nothing much happens in our world. Think about it. Dreams really do fuel our lives. You know, why do kids sign up for Little League? You remember, some of you out there, remember why you signed up for Little League and what you were dreaming of? You were dreaming of hitting that home run in the bottom of the seventh inning and winning the World Series of Little League Baseball. Why do youngsters sign up for dance? They dream of dancing on the stage and having a career in dance and being all dressed up and in shows. Why do we enter college? Because we're dreaming of someday having the job of our dreams and having a certain life. Why do we get married? Because we dream of being miserable. No, I'm just kidding. We dream of a life together with somebody we love. We dream of having kids, having a career. Almost everything we do flows out of some kind of dream in life. And when this church focused exclusively on the second coming of Jesus and the end of the world, they began to stop. They just stopped doing life. And we pick it up in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 when the Apostle Paul has given them all kinds of advice. But we read in verse 5 these words. "Now may the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patience of Christ." Patience of Christ speaking of his coming. "But we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly, and not according to the tradition which he received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to follow us, for we were not disorderly among you, nor did we eat anyone's bread free of charge, but worked with labor and toiled night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you." By the way, the word disorderly literally means to be a do-nothing. It's to sit around and do nothing. Paul is saying, guys, when we were with you, we talked about this. Don't so focus on the end of the world that you sit around doing nothing. Because, folks, when we focus exclusively on the end of the world, we stop dreaming. And when we stop dreaming, we stop living. And so Paul is telling these people, he's the one that established these churches. He's the one that taught them about the coming of Christ. He's the one that taught them about the end of the world. He's saying, guys, you got to start to live again. And so he's telling them, don't hang around people that are being disorderly and doing nothing. He said, you saw our example. We work day and night to provide for ourselves. And he goes on to say, not because we do not have authority. In other words, it's not that we don't have authority to be supported in the ministry from you. He's saying we were setting an example of how to live and how to work and how to wait for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Be engaged in life. He says, but to make ourselves an example of how you should follow us. And this is a verse that is quoted often, but often the context is not quoted. He goes on to say, for even when we were with you, we commanded you this, if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. Now, I've heard that verse. I've said it many times in my career. But I've heard it quoted many more times, and very rarely do we look at the context, which is a group of people that were waiting for the Lord Jesus Christ to come in the end of the world, and they were sitting around doing nothing. He's writing to believers. He's saying, hey, Get back to work. Get focused on living life. Re-engage in life again. And I like to say it, according to today's series, dare to dream again. Because we're not going to be motivated to do anything unless we dream again. And so he says, if we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly, meaning they don't do anything, manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. He's saying, cut it out. Stop it. Get back to work. Is this the end of the world is the wrong question. We should be thinking about how God would have us to engage life again. Is this the end of the world is the wrong question because it kills our dreams. We stop dreaming. We're not going to dream about the future if we think the world is coming to an end. The second reason this is the wrong question is that when we focus on the question, is this the end of the world, exclusively, and just focus on it to the exclusion of everything else, we can't answer the question. No one knows the answer to this question. I personally don't believe this is the end of the world. I want to go on record here, but it could be. I don't know. I could be wrong. I was wrong just last week. Last week I was wrong for the first time in like 8 years. And I said, in fact, you were here when I was wrong. You saw me be wrong last week. Are you ready? I'm going to tell you when I was wrong. I said last week that I turned 40 for the 17th time. That's actually not true. I turned 40 for the 18th time last week. I'm actually 57, if you do the math. I was wrong. I admit it. Now I got another 10 years. I probably won't make another mistake for 10 years. But I'm going to go out on a limb right now. I don't think this is the end of the world. I don't think this is the end of the world the Bible talks about. But I could be wrong. Someday, somebody's going to say it's the end of the world, and they're going to be right. But I like the words of Mark Twain here. I think Mark Twain kind of got some things right, got some things wrong. But when it comes to the end of the world, I'm using his words. I'm kind of putting him in the context of the scripture here. The news of the world's death has been greatly exaggerated in the past. We've all heard of preachers saying they know when the end of the world's coming, that it's coming, that we need to get ready, sell your stock, sell your house, you know, live it up because the world's about to end on a certain day. But the Bible tells us that we don't know the day or the hour. We can't answer that question. It is a question we can sit around and talk about, but we cannot answer. Now, when preachers talk about the end of the world, they often read from Matthew chapter 24. Matthew 24 in the Gospel of Matthew is called the Olivet Discourse because Jesus gave it while he was on the Mount of Olivet, right across from the temple. Valley Kidron went between the temple and where Jesus was on the mountain. Now, scholars agree that this is the most extensive text we have on end times material other than the book of Revelation. They pretty much agreed on that. Now, in Matthew 24:36, Jesus says, and I quote, "But of that day or hour," speaking of the end, speaking of the last day when he returns, when the world's going to end, he says, "But of that day, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but only my Father only." In other words, Jesus is saying, not only did the angels not know, he's saying, I don't even know. So in the most extensive text on the end of the world, other than the book of Revelation, Jesus says no one, not even he, knows when the end of the world is. And so this is a question we cannot answer. Now he says this after verse 35 when he says the world will end. The world will end sometime. He says in verse 35, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away." And then he says, "But no one knows the day or the hour." Now, I don't want to get on a rabbit trail here, but I just want to say this for the record, is that what Jesus is really saying when he says the heaven and earth will pass away, he's saying there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. And the book of Revelation picks up on that later, that the end of the world is not really an end anyway, it's a beginning. But that's for a whole other sermon. I'm much more positive in my eschatology, study of end times, than I've ever been in my life, because I see now the world coming to not to an end of how it is, but it's coming to a new beginning. It's good news. The gospel is good news. Now, that doesn't mean we're not going to have problems in the earth. But I want us to see that spending all our time worrying about whether this is the end of the world could get us in trouble. It could cause us to lose the energy that we need to engage in life and do what God wants us to do. Now, when Jesus talks about the end of the world here in Matthew 24, in fact, let me turn there. He doesn't stop in Matthew 24. He goes on for a couple more chapters, and he kind of illustrates what he's talking about when he talks about not the end of the world itself, knowing the end of the world. He focuses on how to be ready for it when it comes. In other words, we should be focusing not on if the world's going to end or when the world's going to end. We should focus on being ready for when the world ends. And the question for us today is, regardless of where we are in the eschatological timetable and whether the world's going to end in 2 days or 7 years or 7,000 years, are we ready? And in Matthew 24, Jesus concludes that chapter, and he goes into chapter 25, and Jesus gives five examples, five illustrations. He says five things about being ready. In chapter 24, verses 37 through 43, he says they're going to be like the days of Noah. He says, be ready. And how? He answers the question, how? Watch. Pay attention. Keep watching for my return. So we need to be watching, but we don't need to be obsessed. We need to be watching, but we can't get caught up in the fear and the anxiety that thinking about the end of the world can really bring to our lives if we're not careful. I've seen this many times as a pastor, where people will focus to the exclusion of everything else on the end of the world, and their anxiety levels go through the roof. That is not why these scriptures are in the Bible. They're in the Bible to comfort us, tell us how to live so that whenever the end comes, we can be ready. So he goes on from there in Matthew 24, verses 44 through 51. He talks about the faithful servant. Again, he says, how do you be ready? Be faithful. When Jesus returns, when the end of the world comes and new heavens and earth is about to begin, just be faithful, be ready, and you have nothing to worry about. Then in Matthew 25, verses 1 through 12, he talks about a parable called the 10 virgins. And if you read that story, it's all about being ready. Don't fall asleep. Five of them fell asleep and weren't ready for Jesus when he returned. And so the focus is the same. Jesus saying, don't worry about when, worry about how. Worry about being ready when the world ends, when he comes, when he returns, and when there's about to be a new beginning. The fourth story is found in Matthew 25, verses 13 through 30, in something called the parable of the talents. Now, talents is not, he's not speaking of talents in the sense of your abilities. In this context, he's speaking about money, gold, silver, precious commodities that would have been given to a steward, somebody who was to take care of them. Basically, what he says here is very relevant to where we are today. He says, don't let fear stop you from living. If you read that parable in the context of Jesus talking about the end of the world, when he's going to return, and how nobody's going to know, in that story, what got the guy in trouble, that gets in trouble in this story, is he let fear stop him from, if I can say it like this, daring to dream again. He buried his talent. And this was not a good thing. And once again, I don't have time to go into all these stories, but if you read them, this is the context. And the fifth story found here that illustrates what Jesus is saying is found in Matthew 25, 31 through 46, in a story called The Sheep and the Goats, that at the end of the world, at the end of time, when Jesus returns, he's going to sever the sheep from the goats. The sheep will be on his right hand, the goats on his left hand. And this speaks of judgment. But the point, if you read this story, is he tells us how to be ready. He says, when I was cold, you didn't give me a coat. When I was hungry, you didn't feed me. But those that were sheep, they fed the hungry. They served. They served God, and they served others. And so the whole point is, and I know I'm going through this fast, is to help us to be ready, to focus on being ready, not when. And the Thessalonian church was making the mistake of focusing on waiting for Jesus to come instead of how to be ready. And the whole point of the scriptures of talking about someday there'll be a new heavens and new earth is to help us to live in the hope and expectation of Jesus' return, not sit around and not engage in life. We can't know when the world's going to end, but we can know how. Dare to dream again. Dare to dream again. Right now, I mean, this is the last few weeks have been really crazy in our country, and I'm going through a lot of the emotions that you're going through, but I'm making myself shut the news off sometimes. I mean, I'm paying attention, make sure I know what's going on, but I'm trying not to get obsessed with all this stuff, and I want to help you to dare to dream again, and I'm making myself think about where we're going as a church. Where is my life going as an individual? What do I dream about for my kids? And more than that, asking what God dreams about for my kids and for my life and for this church. And so I dare you to dream again. You remember when you were a young kid and you would dare each other? I dare you to eat, you know, like hot sauce on your hamburger. Or I dare you to eat three ice creams and with cookies on top. And then we'd say, I double dare you. I double dare you to begin to dream again about what God has for your life. God still has a dream for our lives. I know right now it looks dark. I know right now it's kind of fearful. There's good reason to be anxious. People can make an argument for the fact that the world's coming to an end. You know, I was watching a, a television show just recently, and the preacher began to talk about all the signs of the end, that things that are happening in the news are fulfilling. He just forgot to tell us one thing. He forgot to tell me what scriptures were being fulfilled. And everything he was saying was assumption. And I'll talk about that in just a moment. Is this the end of the world? Is the wrong question. Because it's hard to dream when we're focusing on the end of the world. It's the wrong question because we don't know when the end will be. And Jesus makes it very clear that what we need to focus on is being ready for when the end comes. And the third reason why I believe that this is the wrong question is that when you look at Matthew 24 and the text that we've seen that is the most extensive text on the end times, it has nothing to do with coronavirus or riots in America. As I was saying, I was watching this TV show the other day. I just decided I was going to kind of peruse Christian TV and what preachers are saying. And because I do that periodically, I want to know what's going on. I want to know what people are thinking, because I've said at the beginning of this sermon, I can be wrong. So I'm constantly listening to preachers and speakers that I don't always agree with. And if they're smart, they're listening to people they don't agree with, because they'll help you learn. I've learned a lot from people that I disagree with. And hopefully you do too. You know, remember the old TV commercial? I probably shouldn't say this. You can learn a lot from a dummy. You can even learn from me. Okay? You don't have to agree with everything I'm saying, but we can learn from one another, and we can listen to one another. So that's what I was doing. I was listening to somebody who had a certain take on the end times, and as I was watching them, he kept saying, this fulfills prophecy, and this fulfills prophecy, and this fulfills prophecy. But not once did he ever show me what prophecies were being fulfilled. There were assumptions. Folks, we've got to be careful of this. We've got to be careful as we look at the Scripture. We hijack the Scripture if we're not careful. When prophecy preachers talk about the end times from Matthew 24, I've heard them say, I've said it. In my early days, I used to do this more often than I do now. It's been a subject because I studied the end times a lot in my early days, and it's one of my pet subjects. I love studying eschatology. But when we preachers, I'll say it like this, when we preachers speak about the end times, we'll say, and the Bible predicts that earthquakes will come. And it does. And the Bible predicts wars and rumors of wars. And it does. And the Bible predicts false prophets will rise up. And it does. And the Bible predicts brother will betray brother. And it does. But the context of these verses isn't 20th century America. It's first century Jerusalem and its temple. Let's read Matthew 24 verses 1 through 2. It says, Jesus then went out and departed from the temple in Jerusalem, which was standing when this was written, when Jesus did this. And his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, do you not see all these things? What things? The things of the temple. Assuredly, I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. Now here, I don't have time to dissect this whole text. It would take me weeks. There's so much information in this chapter that we could learn. But I'm not as interested in getting the information across as I am in encouraging you to look at the context. Here's the thing. Outside of Jesus' context, this prophecy doesn't predict anything. Now, I know this sounds like heresy. And there's probably people right now going, oh, I can't believe Pastor Bob said that. But it's not heresy. It's intellectual honesty. Jesus says in verse, let me prove this to you. Jesus said in Matthew 6 and 7, he says, and you will hear of wars and rumors of war. See that you're not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom will rise against kingdom, and there will be famine, pestilence, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Now, at first glance, it'd be easy to read this and say, see, our world is ending. There's wars and rumors of war, and yet there are. There are famines. You could find it on a newspaper or on the internet. You can find there's famines in the world. And certainly there's pestilence, there's coronavirus. I heard last week they're worried about Ebola virus getting back up again. There's earthquakes. There's earthquakes in the earth, and we can find them. But these things, folks, have always taken place. I'm a history buff. I love to read history. There's nothing unique about what Jesus is saying here outside of its context. When you read history, you're going to find history is filled with wars. You don't think so? Pick up a history book. One thing human beings have learned how to do well is fight. What about pestilences? As I said, you ever hear of Ebola? What about H1N1, swine flu? You know, in those days, they would have considered that a pestilence. Okay? They would have considered that a plague. Then there's earthquakes. Did you know that Delaware, the state of Delaware, has had 59 recorded earthquakes since 1871? Who knows how many they had before that? Wars, pestilence, famines, earthquakes, they've been happening throughout history. What makes this prophecy of Jesus so powerful is the context. Jesus spoke these words during something called the Pax Romana. The Pax Romana was a 200-year period of time in Roman history that they had relative peace and stability throughout the entire Roman Empire. Nobody messed with Rome. In fact, Josephus talks about this in his histories. If you look up Josephus, he talks about, he almost quotes the book of Revelation. What he says is just like the book of Revelation, which says, who can make war with Rome? Where in Revelation it says, who can make war with the beast? Who is Rome? There was a period of time during Roman history that started with Augustus Caesar in 27 BC and lasted until the time of Marcus Aurelius in 180 AD. This was a period when they had relative peace. Nobody messed with Rome except one period of time around 69 AD. In 69 AD, they had something called the Year of the Four Caesars, where the Roman Empire almost came unglued and almost fell apart. At this time period, the Temple of Jerusalem was destroyed. And guess what the subject of Jesus' message is in Matthew 24? It's the end of the temple. It's the destruction of the temple. Now, no matter how people interpret the book of Revelation, people admit, scholars admit, that this prophecy was fulfilled in 70 AD. They don't argue about that. But there is arguments on whether it's going to happen again and what some of the specifics are. And folks, there's grounds for disagreement. But we can, most of us can agree on the fact that this is pretty accurate when it comes to the context of what Jesus is speaking. And if you notice, if you take and read Matthew 24 verses 1 through 34, before he talks about the new heavens and the new earth, Jesus tells them when. His focus is on when. I want you to read this yourself and notice all the when references. In verse 6, he says, not yet. In verse 14, he says, after then the end will come. In verse 15, he says, when you see. In verse 16, he says, then let. Then he says in verse 21, then. Verse 23, then. Verse 29, after. Verse 30, then. Verse 32, when. Verse 33, when. Verse 34, this generation shall not pass, will by no means pass, until all these things take place. And guess what? All those things did take place in first century Israel. Even though they interpret the book of Matthew differently, most of them agree on that. But then Jesus shifts gears and talks about the end of the world. Now here's the conclusion I'm trying to bring us to. It's okay to study eschatology. It's okay to study the end of times. Just be careful you don't obsess over it. I don't think this is the end of the world. I don't think where we are is the end of the world. But I can tell you, I can see some real similarities. And for those that interpret the book of Revelation and Matthew 24 in a certain fashion called the spiritual method, where things in these prophecies are going to recycle and recapitulate and happen again, they have a strong argument. Even for those that interpret these things from what they call a futurist point of view, and you'd have to read my book. I explain all those in my book, The Book of Revelation, Heavenly Worship Service, which you can get on Amazon. Plug my book a little bit. This is a different form of interpreting these things. I can see that some of the things they're saying could be happening. However, that's not what Jesus is talking about. Jesus isn't talking about when he talks about pestilences in the world. He's not talking about the coronavirus. That's not the context. And we've got to be careful when we use Scripture to begin to speak to some of the things that are happening around us, because it's very easy to misuse Scripture. And I'm just warning us. Because, folks, we need Jesus when he's talking about the end. Even if this is, if you can prove to me that this is the end of the world, and I'm open. I hope it isn't. I hope it's the beginning. I can't wait for Jesus to come. But if this is really the end of the world, Jesus is still telling us to be ready. And you can't be ready when we obsess about the end. Dare to dream again. I just want to encourage you. There's a lot of things being said out there. We're going to look at some things more closely about the end times in a series. I think I'm going to call it Not Alone in the month of July. Next month I might do this. I'm still praying about it and working through it. But we're not alone in all this. We just need to be ready. We need to go about life again. We need to re-engage in life. We need to take the exhortations of Paul to the church in Thessalonica And we need to stop being disorderly. We need to stop doing nothing. We need to get back to some kind of normal, which we're going to talk about next week. We need to dare to dream again. Let me talk to the young people out there. Young people, God has a dream for your lives. Dare to dream. Don't let the coronavirus and all the upheavals in society rob your life of hearing what God has for you. Older people, I know as we get older, it's easy to get more anxious and fearful and negative and pessimistic. I have to fight this at this stage in my life at times. I want to encourage you and me to dare to dream again. I can't prove to you that this isn't the end of the world, but I think the odds are with me. Everybody who said it's been in the end of the world before was wrong. So I'm banking on the fact this isn't the end of the world, but someday it's going to come. Let's just be ready. And how are we ready? How do we get ready? We let God give us his dream for our lives, and we live it out. I dare you. I double dare you. Next week, we'll be looking at normal. We're going to go back to normal or not. We'll have some things to share with you about that from Scripture and some practical things. But for now, why don't you join us as we close in worship, followed by Pastor Jay sharing with us more of what's happening here at The Nest. May God bless you. Dare to dream again. And let's close in worship and get excited about life once again and engage in life.
Worthy is the King who conquered.
You know, I wasn't sure at first if Pastor Bob was talking about my pool shooting skills or my golf game. But either way, I think I will choose hope over despair. There are times when I'm ready just to throw my clubs into the pond, but then I hit that nice shot and it keeps me coming back. So choose hope over despair. Listen, I'm glad you decided to join us today online. If you're new to Eagle's Nest, we want to give you a special welcome. We have a very stylish t-shirt for you for free. I'd like to send you that if you'll send me an email at hello@eaglesnest.ch. I'd love to say hi and answer any questions you may have about Eagle's Nest Ministries. Now, if you'll stay with me for just a few more minutes, we're going to close the service today with a special tribute to our 2020 graduates. While you're online, you can check out the webpage. Go to our Facebook page, either the main page or the kids page. Follow and like those. You can check us out on Instagram. And we also have an internal program to connect our own folks using Realm. These are all quick and easy ways for you and your family to get information quickly about everything happening here at the Nest. You may be asking, how do I give to Eagle's Nest? You can show up here for our live service at 9:30 and drop it in a basket. You can use the old-fashioned snail mail, and the physical address is located at the bottom of our website page. Or you can go to our website. To the top right, there's a word that says give, and we have two safe and secure online giving platforms that you can fill out and easily give to Eagle's Nest Ministry, and we thank you in advance. If you're considering attending live church, we are now open. Eagle's Nest is open for business, both online and live, and that will continue for the foreseeable future. And just a few reminders, Eagle's Nest, that I'd like to point out for you. Our own Beth O'Brien has put together an online Bible study for our ladies' ministry entitled Armor of God. You don't want to miss it. You can go to our website, to Facebook, or to Realm to sign up now. We also want to remind you that Eagle's Nest Kids is very active during this otherwise inactive period, and our very own Sherry Yerkes, Children's Director, has put together a special event for our kids and parents entitled Virtual Meetups. They happen on Mondays. Go to our website to find out more information. And now to our graduates of 2020. What a year to remember. I mean, right now it looks hard and looks like you're getting the short straw, no doubt about that. But think about it, you're going to be famous. This is going to show up in the history books, no doubt, as a special time in history. Hopefully, our graduates can apply this sermon today. Dare to dream again, because there will be brighter days, and you do have a future and a hope in Christ. Enjoy this video.
I am so incredibly proud of my daughter, Faith Palmer. She has excelled in both academics and extracurricular activities. She has worked hard, overcoming all obstacles to achieve her goals. She has been an amazing friend and support person to those close to her. I am excited for all she will accomplish in her future, and I know God has powerful plans for her. I love you.
Take
57.
Wait. What take is this? Whatever. So, hey guys, we're Jason and Leia Dipsky. We are the parents of Isabel Dipsky. I cannot tell you how proud of her we are. She will be heading off to Fairleigh Dickinson University in Madison, New Jersey, studying English literature and education. Hopefully she will be heading off in a couple of years to study abroad where she's always been dreaming. Ladybug, we are so super proud of you. We cannot wait to see what God has in store for you. We are so proud of everything that you have accomplished over the last few years. We are sorry that your senior year did not end the way you were hoping it would end.
Love you. Can't wait to see what you do.
Reach for the stars and dream big. Love you.
Hi, I want to tell you a little bit about my son, Jaron. He's gone by many names. J. Louie, Jaxel, Jerbear, Jaron, Jerone, just to name a few. I call him my gentle giant, with J, of course. He sang karaoke to a song that he wrote when he was 3. He saw Dad's hospital bed, and the other kids wanted to take a ride on it. No, he was underneath trying to figure out how it worked. And that's Jaren in a nutshell. He tries to figure out how things work, and creative, the boy is creative. He likes to put things together. He asks questions that I've never thought to ask, like, why does your nose run when you cry? He asked that at 5. What do you do with that? He started asking for coal for Christmas when he was 12 and started spending his birthday money buying things to blacksmith with. I'm just really impressed and just can hardly wait to see what God's going to do with this creative mind and this gentle soul. We've always prayed that his heart would stay tender toward God, and I see that, and I'm so grateful for the man that he's becoming. Just a unique kid. I love him.
Leah, this message is twofold. First of all, to congratulate you on such an incredible job the last 12 years, specifically for handling COVID with the way that you did, with such grace and dignity and finishing out strong. I could not be more proud of you and who you are. The second part of this message is for the rest of the world. And I just want to say, watch out, because Leah is coming at you with everything that God created her to be, with her sense of justice and her strong sense of compassion and her constant search for truth based on the Word of God. Leah, you are going to make a marked difference in the spirit realm, and I cannot wait to see what God does with your way.
So Leah, I just want to say how much I love you and so proud of you for your accomplishments, and I cannot wait to see what God has in store for the rest of your life. You're an incredible young lady. I love you so much.
Happy graduation, Leah. Love you. Good job.
Braden, we wanted to say how proud we are of you for your 4 years of hard work in high school and all of the accomplishments you achieved. We pray God will be with you throughout your college life and the rest of your life as well. And together, we just wanted to say as a family,
congratulations, Braden. We love you.
We hope you enjoyed that small tribute to our 2020 graduates. No, it probably wasn't enough, but we're so happy to see your faces, and we wish you all the best as you pursue what God has for your lives. And if you're struggling and unable to dream again, you need prayer, counseling, or you just want someone to talk to, it would be our privilege to talk with you further. Or if you don't know the one that promises to give us a future and a hope, I'd like to send you this Max Lucado pamphlet to introduce you to our Savior. Whatever the need is, please send us a note at hello@eaglesnest.ch and allow one of our pastors to connect with you. Take care. We'll see you next week, either live or online, right here at 9:30.